From Turner Broadcasting System, you're watching Superstation WTBS, Atlanta.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is time again for Baby Oil and Blow.
You.
I am Matto. With me as always, he is Hakeem the African American Dream to my big boss man. I'm talking about Nate Adams.
Ahoy, ahoy, everybody. Did you use that metaphor because we're so
tall?
Yeah. We're both so very tall.
No, it's 9/11, dog.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, never forget.
A couple of Twin Towers, me and you. So, you're looking real jacked there, brother. Looking real jacked.
How Likewise,
you feeling?
Dude.
Feeling good?
You look shredded, man.
This is a good day for us, I feel like.
Yeah, I'd say I feel like $1 million, but that'd be taking a pay cut.
Okay, there's that beer.
Boom.
I should really be rehydrating today. I had a long weekend of drinking too much. A lot of drinking too much.
It's called Hero the Dog.
Yeah, I'm going to persevere. I'm going to drink a beer while we do this.
It's the only way to do it.
Talk not wrestling.
No,
this week.
No,
a little wrestling this 80s time.
80s pro wrestling.
Gotta go back and forth. Get both flavors. Last week, we were up north watching some Vince McMahon wrestling. This week, we're gonna go down south, watch some southern wrestling.
R-A-S-S-L-I-N, that's wrestling.
And there was flavor.
Yeah.
That's for
yeah.
Sure.
This is my preferred flavor of wrestling. Back in the day, you know,
yeah,
a little more real. These guys.
Those
look
real.
Like jacked up like comic book characters.
They some of them did.
Mostly look like gross dads.
A lot of them did.
Speedos.
Yeah.
They go by their real names a lot. You know, they're trying to make it look more like a real fight.
Yeah.
You know, like you get a lot of theatrical stuff in the northern wrestling.
Seemed like a sporting
stage
product.
Stage show. These guys are trying to be like, hey, let's fake pretend like we're in a fight.
This is a real sport.
I like it. They're holding on to that last little grasp of hope that like, ooh, maybe we can still convince people that wrestling is real.
Yeah. The rubes. The marks.
It didn't work.
No.
Because, you know, southern wrestling doesn't really exist anymore.
No.
But
wrestling doesn't exist anymore.
Back on November 2nd, 1985, it did.
It was real.
Every Saturday, 6:05 Eastern, going back to the early 70s. First, it was Georgia Championship Wrestling. Then it was World Championship Wrestling. Eventually, it was WCW Saturday Night. Either way, it came on 5 minutes later than every other show for whatever goddamn reason, and it was a long-standing tradition, and it was great.
Wrestling fans are never on time.
So let's talk. That's true. Yeah, that is a stereotype.
Never on time.
I mean, except for when you go see those pay-per-views at the Hooters.
Oh.
Could, like, 6 or 7 hours before.
Oh, yeah.
Definitely aren't.
Line them up.
Hooters doesn't have those TVs going. Like, if it's like getting like, ooh, like 10 minutes, 5 minutes till that pay per view is supposed to start, and like it's not on the TVs yet, you start looking at those merchants.
What's the PPV?
They start sweating.
What's the PPV?
Little forehead veins bulging. Excuse me, waitress.
They're still doing those, right?
I gotta think if there's still Hooters in the world, there's gotta still be wrestling.
You got a couple Hooters ins, right?
Hooters in the world.
You got a couple Hooters ins.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Ins and outs.
Yeah, talk to somebody. Find out, because if so, I think, you know, we should, for old time's sake.
Start watching 80s wrestling pay-per-views at Hooters?
Yeah, I don't think they'd tell us no on a Sunday night.
No, definitely not.
Yeah, especially during football season. But let's get into this, man, because there's so much to get into.
Yeah, this is really just a lot of little segments, coming one after another. It felt like it was like late 90s.
Just rapid
Monday
fire.
Night Raw, just like...
Yeah.
Every week trying to shove 10 pounds of shit in a 5-pound bag on that Raw. And now here in
the
80s. They
kept shoving.
We've already got that high-paced TV going down here, down south.
Yeah, they kick it off fast and wild with that little clip.
Straight up, just like you're watching the Midnight Express jumping Jimmy Valiant.
Yep.
And then there's a man dressed as a woman in the ring suddenly.
No, that's a lady.
And then it just ends like just 8 seconds of context-free like insanity. That
and
was
then,
a weird way to start a show.
But... The main thing is you start it off like that, and then you don't bother talking about it
No.
until the last 5 minutes of the show. But we'll get to that.
Wondering if that was like some sort of editing mistake. Like, did he accidentally show a clip from last week? And then like, oh, no, wait, here we go. Here, we're going to start the show
now. We're
not
going to talk about what we just saw, but that's okay. Because they got a great theme song, and they had to get right to it.
Yeah, we'll play some of that theme song so everybody can hear it and know what we're talking about here. So coming out of that, we go into Tony Schiavone and David Crockett, our announcers, introducing the show. Tony Schiavone, very young man.
Talking like a turd.
Forget that 10 pounds of gold. How about that 10 pounds of hair that was on Schiavone's head?
Yeah.
Like, that guy had a hair helmet back then. It was crazy. He looked youthful and spry. Probably, I don't know, some prenatal vitamins or something he had to have been taking. Because that
he sounded like a real fake announcer dork, though.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Like, and he was always bad at it. But here he was especially bad at it.
I think standing next to David Crockett, he looked pretty excellent.
Well,
he looked like a real professional who knew exactly what he was doing standing next to David Crockett.
It's like somebody forgot to tell Big Dave, you know, that they'd gone live and that he needed to wake up.
It's like his brother forgot to tell him that he doesn't care if they're brothers. He's not allowed to host their wrestling show.
Yeah, which is nuts because that Jim Crockett comes across as a real ball of fire himself every time he's on the screen.
Real straight shooter, except for when it comes to family. And suddenly we got nepotism all over the place.
But the live audience, great touch.
Uh-huh.
I like that.
Yeah.
It's making
people look like they got bust in from one of those sister wives' churches.
Oh, absolutely. But it makes you feel like you're watching something, a real event here.
They were
must-see TV.
They were excited to be crammed in that tiny TV studio.
Yeah, it was tiny.
I hope they had air conditioning, or it would have been like 200 degrees in there.
Everybody's wearing sweaters, and it's the South. I don't understand.
Tiny little room.
It was a weird setup, but they all seemed like they knew what they were doing.
And there's people of all ages in the crowd, too, which is
absolutely
that
every
me. Like
age.
Grandmas, little kids, everything in between. Yeah. Like, these days, you go to wrestling shows, and it's little kids, and it's like 30-year-old virgins.
Yep.
And nothing else.
That's
nothing
it.
Nothing else in between
nothing
whatsoever.
Else. No.
Back then, you know, they were fishing with a much wider net, it seemed like.
Oh, yeah.
Pulling in not just bigger numbers, but wider demographics. Oops. And, you know, it's because wrestling was so much better then. You got jerks screaming their heads off. Yacked out of their minds. Oh, great stuff.
Great stuff.
We're leading into Starrcade here.
Yep.
So
big
we
time
start
of the year.
Off, we got to build the top matches. We're seeing some clips of Magnum TA versus Tully Blanchard. Kind of get across the fact that these guys are feuding and it's out of control.
Yeah.
It's violent. They won't stop fighting each other. And how's it going to end, Matt?
Well, I'd like to establish one thing that we haven't established yet.
Okay.
And this is for the course of this show going forward.
Yeah.
And that is you and I are two of the world's foremost experts on the subject of grudge.
Oh, and grudge is brewing here.
We're
like,
past.
It's bubbling
over.
Yeah,
like grudge like, is, yeah, has been.
I don't even know if we're going to make it to Starrcade. These two are at each other's throats so terribly. Just every time they see each other, wailing away on each other. Last time they fought, this little match we're getting clips from, both of them just passed out from exhaustion. Match couldn't end.
Battered
therefore,
and bloodied.
We got to find a new way to end it, which gets developed later. The ref uniforms in this little clip were nice. The big wide collars, like bright colored collars to offset the pretty bland standard zebra stripe. I liked it. It was a nice little touch.
Yeah, they looked
felt
good.
Very, very late 70s, early 80s.
Oh, absolutely.
Getting a lot of that like in these shows, like mid 80s, and there's still just all these 70s like fashion trends hanging around in the world of wrestling. Like you feel like the world of wrestling is a good like 5 years behind everybody
which
else.
Which is weird. Because they always seem so stylish.
Yeah, you go to a different country,
touch.
All the cars are like 5 years old.
Yeah.
Like, that's what it's like.
Yeah.
Professional wrestling is like a third world country.
Wow, that's surprisingly accurate.
Definitely.
I mean, just on the button there. But let's kick it off. We got some in-ring action after, you know, the
little
clips. Oh,
yeah, our first proper match.
This is one of the longer matches of the night.
Oh, these matches, they come and go. When they have squash matches, they have squash matches.
Don't blink.
20 seconds, 30 seconds, jeez.
This was the Raging Bull. Was it Manny Fernandez?
Manny Fernandez. Very proud of his Mexican heritage.
Versus Tommy Lane.
Guy named Tommy Lane.
He had nice blonde hair.
Yeah, he did. Manny Fernandez weirdly had one spot of hair that was sort of dyed blonde a little bit.
I don't know,
but
the
not
thing
all the way
that I kept asking myself while watching the Raging Bull
mm-hmm.
was, is that Mike Awesome's dad?
Oh, you think Mike Awesome might have a little bit of the fiery Latino blood in him?
He could be. I mean, he just looked like Mike Awesome with a mustache working a Mexican gimmick.
Both kind of have similar, like, big, goofy guy mannerisms. Yeah. I could definitely see that. Both these guys kind of looked like the jobber, quite frankly. Like,
yeah, I was not familiar with either
until
one.
Until Manny took control of the match, I was just like, all right, which one here is our featured star, and which one's the scrub? You're the guy we're
getting over here.
Tommy Lane was the scrub. God bless him for doing the work.
He took that flying burrito.
Yeah, real quick match. Manny ends it with a flying burrito, mm-hmm. which we saw Tito Santana last week up there in the WWF. He's doing a flying forearm. They're calling the flying burrito.
Flying burrito.
Manny Fernandez is doing a flying forearm. They're calling. Is that the only move Mexicans were allowed to do in the 1980s?
Well, might be some of our classic 1980s. Man. That's racist wrestling.
Yeah, it's definitely like this wouldn't happen to a white guy. A guy like what's some stereotypical thing white people like? Harley Race finishes the match with the unseasoned chicken. Like,
yes,
killing him over here.
Yes,
it's ridiculous. This should not stand. I demand that our two Mexican wrestlers, Manny Fernandez and Tito Santana, get treated with more respect going forward.
They will. They'll get their
solid flying burrito, though. Like,
yeah, it was. It looked good.
Got some momentum on it.
He had some ups. He looked good. I liked the small crowd. It was good for shit talking. You could really hear.
Oh yeah, the mic was
when people had opinions.
People just jaw jacking.
Which was nice.
Speaking of jaw jacking, after this match, we go into the master jaw jacker, the greatest interview of all time. Nature Boy Ric Flair.
Our first appearance of Flair on the show.
Jesus Christ, was he wearing a gaudy suit?
I thought it was pretty relaxed myself.
Well, maybe in the grand scheme of the 1980s, but looking at that suit with the eyes of a modern man, insane.
It was like, what, a solid like tan or cream underneath, like vest pants combo?
When you're walking around.
And then a real nice checkered
looking
coat.
Looking like that, yeah. You're catching eyes. People are, who's that guy? He must either be insane or famous.
Yeah.
Turns out in this case, it's both.
Yeah, he's 100% both of those things.
Yelling about being college educated.
Oh,
man. World's greatest physicians.
Yeah, his father.
Yeah, he was
he was the greatest physician in all of Minnesota.
Really,
I got it right here in my notes.
Really off on a tangent there.
Yeah.
But, you know, being braggadocious, it's very important. Like, whatever you're going to talk about, be bragging.
He's,
make sure you're bragging.
He's talking shit about Mr. Dusty Rhodes.
Which you got to.
And
another one of the big matches we got coming up.
I think we're past the early stages of grudge here.
Oh, I mean.
And we got.
They broke Dusty's leg. Like,
yeah.
We're like in post-grunge here.
Yeah, we're a good couple steps into grudge here.
Like, they got through their grudge, and now they're coming all the way back around, and they're going to build like a second. It's like you're at the old country buffet of grudge here. Like, they ate their plate of grudge. They sat back. They unbuttoned their pants. They smoked a cigarette.
Now they're
going back. Second plate of grudge.
Yeah.
Great line in this when he yelled, he was a great Heisman Trophy winner. Now he's just another guy.
I loved Flair's inclusion of real sports. He was talking about some dude for the Buckeyes that broke his foot.
Absolutely.
And a big upset that happened over the weekend.
His names are flying right over my head. But
he's making you feel like, hey, that's a sport. So is this.
Sure.
They're related.
Equate these guys together.
We are all athletes.
Pro wrestlers are the realest of athletes.
Yeah.
So
he
why
said,
not speak
I think he says in that promo how it's the most difficult of all sports.
Well, I mean, clearly.
Yeah.
What other sports are you forced to cut your forehead open and then bleed all over a bunch of like yokels that are sitting 3 feet away from you?
Pretty sure I saw Ken Griffey Jr. do that once.
Yeah, synchronized swimming I can think of, but that's the only other one.
Yeah, that's what sport I was thinking of.
After that, we go into a little interview with a couple of Flair's friends and cousins, actually. We're being led to believe Arn and Ole Anderson, the Minnesota Wrecking Crew. Flair, great, 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 great heel. These guys, other than Flair, probably the other two best heels in the goddamn world.
Just killing it. Absolutely crushing it.
It's amazing how much... They're not quite the horsemen yet. These guys are just about to
form up
and call themselves the horsemen, but how much they were just relying on this one group of guys to carry every show. Like, every other segment, these guys were coming back out there.
You got Arn in what might be the look of the night, which is just shirtless, but he's got two gold chains,
fucking
a gold watch.
Pinky ring,
he's got the pinky ring going.
Big-ass block of gold.
He's got his Coke shades. Finger. He's killing it. He's how you want to look. He's Ole how you Anderson, want your wrestlers
just
to look.
Like, everyone's angry dad. Like that dad
man.
Wouldn't be embarrassed to just yell and holler when there was like other kids over. He would just like scream at his kids in front of anyone. Like that's Ole Anderson.
Yeah, you're like, oh, let's come over to my house. And all your friends are like, I don't know. Is your dad there?
Shirtless down in the basement screaming at you kids. Just like
screaming.
Oh, man, it's like dinner time, and he's not going to let you eat there. It's
he's not
like,
your dad, but you're still worried he might hit you.
We have enough money to feed my kids.
Yeah.
You need to go sit on the porch while we have dinner.
And then the mom speaks up, and he's like, I know how much Mark and Pam make. He can go home and eat there.
Come on. You know Mark and Pam don't cook dinner.
But they could. If
they're out at a fancy sizzler. And those fishbowl
parties. Oh, those 1980s fishbowl parties.
Warm up some chicken fingers. I don't get nothing from these two. Life sucked ever since Mark's moved in. He's dead.
Mark and Pam.
That NWA TV title is one of my favorites. That's a classic looking belt.
That's
the red and silver. Great design.
Good
Arms
looking.
Just propping it up right in the camera so you can see like I'm the TV champion, motherfucker.
Well, they're on TV.
I'm the champion of television. We're on
television. I'm the champion of what you are watching currently.
That's big shit.
Yep.
They're putting over Dusty. Once again, like he's a real athlete, talking about how it's insane that he's coming back so quick from that broken leg, how he can't do it.
But they keep, and I love this, this is great heel stuff, they keep just talking about how stupid he is for coming back. Not just like, what a brave soul, like this is a tough guy. They're like, you're an idiot. Everyone said you shouldn't.
He looked at Dusty Rhodes, I mean, he's clearly not the brightest man in the world.
He's the son of a plumber, not the son of the greatest physician in all of Minnesota.
It's smart to draw that sort of
stark
difference between the two because, Ric Flair, classy gentleman. His leg's not broken.
Not at all.
You know, why would he let that happen? So I think coming into this Starrcade match, he's got a big time advantage over Dusty Rhodes.
Dusty Rhodes.
Son of a plumber.
Long on guts. Short on brains.
From one Nature Boy to another, we go into our next match. We got Nature Boy Buddy Landell.
Buddy Landell.
He's in there fighting a scrub named Tony Zane.
Tony Zane. Sammy Zane's father.
Yeah, nice. His Italian father.
Yep. Tony Zane.
This is like Buddy Landell, much like Ric Flair, just sort of ripped off Buddy Rogers' gimmick. They're both doing it at the same time.
Yep.
He's like the Filmation Nature Boy a little bit.
It's all weird.
Around. Old
with
jalopy
the three
with
Nature
gorilla.
Boys. And the fact that you got Buddy Landell and he's doing that same off the ropes Ric Flair knee to the face.
Just talking like a Tennessee hillbilly.
Yeah,
like,
it's weird.
You can't really pull that gimmick off when you just sound like a Tennessee hillbilly whenever you open your goddamn mouth.
Yeah, it's like if when NWO had fake Sting, if they would have let fake Sting talk and he had like some like real like trashy English accent or something.
Yeah, sure.
You know, like,
and then
oh,
it was just
boy.
Like wrestling also
oh,
on
I'm
the
Sting.
Same shows as Sting, like in totally separate feuds, like not interacting.
It was weird.
Worlds colliding. Famous back in the 1980s for having the biggest tits of the period was Dolly Parton. I mean, she built a whole career on it, but I gotta say, Tony Zane's, I think, were a little bit bigger.
I think
Tony Zane should have been getting a little bit of that titty money back there in the 1980s.
Yeah, a little credit where credit's due.
Must not have been able to market himself well, but... This is another squash match. Like, what was this? 25 seconds, 30 seconds?
If
like,
that, man. It was...
Landell comes out, kicks his ass, puts him in that figure four, puts him away.
That was that.
And man, you even got J.J. Dillon as Landell's manager, and he's going to become Flair's manager.
Here. Right? Like, you're just waiting.
Very soon.
You're watching
now.
This, just thinking so what could be. But I got to say, Mr. J.J. Dillon, I'm on to you.
Oh.
And I know...
What's he have to hide?
He's kind of in bed with some of the boys up north.
You don't say.
I know for a fact he was clothes shopping with Gorilla Monsoon.
Because
they essentially got the Dumb and Dumber tux going where one wears one color and one wears the other.
And most importantly, you got that ruffled shirt. I do not remember ruffled shirts being a thing in the 1980s when I think back to real life. And then when I'm watching this pro wrestling shit,
There
are ruffled fucking dress shirts right and left.
JJ and Gorilla arm in arm, buying ruffled shirts together, colored ruffled shirts.
Absolutely. Where do you got to go to, like, Greenwich Village to buy a shirt like that or something in 1985? Like, where are they finding these things?
Probably. I mean, because, like, that's not cheap. That's a fine dye. Like, that's not a cheap
hip
dye.
Hip resale shops, maybe? Yeah. I don't know. Or is it just all they all have dads who died and, like, willed them down all their clothes? Like,
take my ruffled shirts.
Wear all my dad's old clothes after he died. It's great.
Wear them on wrestling.
Save a lot of money. Like, I don't.
Yeah, they're thrifty, I guess.
You know, life on the road, I got to buy a lot of cheeseburgers and cocaine. Take all the clothes out of my budget.
Road sodas. Don't forget the road sodas.
Oh, yeah, pounding road soda after road soda out there.
But they weren't picky. You just get a case of whatever, and that's that.
Oop, hit a tree. Keep going. Yeah. You just took the mirror off.
Yeah, it's no big deal.
We got a town to make. This is 1980s pro wrestling. Yeah,
keep it going.
Do a line. Keep going.
It was an express train to the next town. Like that, that's called a segue. Express.
Wow. Yeah, because who's coming up next? George South?
Yeah, George South.
What's that have to do with Express? I don't get it.
And Mike Davis.
Okay, yeah. Mike Davis, who I don't remember. George South, perennial jobber.
Yes.
Icon of 1980s.
Yeah.
L's. Just L column losses.
Just
when it comes
getting
to the
it
world
done for the other team.
80s wrestling. They're against the Rock and Roll Express.
The Rock and Roll Express.
Maybe the greatest goddamn babyface tag team of all time.
Oh, which I just don't understand.
What are you talking about? They're great.
Oh, they're so just flabby and ugly.
Because I thought they were in pretty good shape here. I was,
yeah, for Rock and Roll Express standards.
For them,
they were,
like,
in great shape.
Oh, my. There's, like, only...
They're really kind of fat.
Yeah, there's negligible loose skin around these guys right now. Like, they're looking kind of in shape, just a couple of ugly idiots, which is weird because they're really pushed and accepted by the fans as being, like,
as heartthrobs.
Young, yeah, like heartthrob, really lookers.
And
like,
Morton looks like he's in his 40s.
Oh, man. Morton probably never looked young.
No, probably not.
Robert, he looks okay. I mean, later on in life, he got, like, you know, super tubby and started looking
He's
bad.
He's got those weird dead southern eyes where you can't tell if his mom was just drinking when she was pregnant or if it's like he's got siblings that are, or, you know, an aunt and uncle that are really cousins or something somewhere in there, you know.
You know, we call that southern sexy. He's...
Okay, I guess
I'm buying him as a heartthrob a little bit more.
I guess so.
Than
I
Ricky.
Dead
Ricky.
Eyes.
Oh, God.
Like a doe's eyes.
Yeah. Great goddamn wrestler. This guy... sells his ass off. Gets the fans going. Everything he does.
They're good.
Builds up to that big comeback.
I don't understand it.
Their leg work in this match right here. Mm-hmm. Just picked a body part, stuck to that body part. That's the thing you're seeing in every one of these matches on this show. So much more than those matches up north. These guys are really just making it look like they're really trying to fight. Like they've really got a strategy. Yeah. Like they're sticking to these strategies. Like, okay, this is how we're going to do it. We're going to win this fight. Whereas up there, it's more just like, all right, I'm going to convey to an audience that I'm having a fight. And
look at me.
Yeah,
I'm fighting.
It's a difference between, like a stage fight, like, and just like a real sport that you happen to be watching. They're taking that extra step here to just make this stuff look like they're really trying to win.
Yeah.
Trying to have it make sense.
And it looks like athletes performing.
And you know, for... people down south to try and use logic and reason, like,
oh heavens,
sorry, I like the South. They're very charming people.
Well, yeah,
very warm, charming people.
Yeah,
they make disgusting, fattening food.
They still got them topless diners down there.
Last time I drove through the South, there was a couple topless diners, and I always just think about, like, you know, spurting little bacon grease, like. Mm-hmm. Hitting those titties.
Oh, careful.
Yeah.
Careful, that's a hot plate.
I feel for those topless waitresses. That's got to be a tough row to hoe.
I think of that, and then I think of Mr. Steiner's Shoney's that he owns down there.
There's no toplessness there. That's a...
Oh, no, it's a family establishment, pal.
Professional operation. Yeah. Start to finish Scott Steiner's Shoney's that he owns, which we're probably going to have to take a road trip to. And
I'm hoping
maybe
live podcast.
Down there. Rock and roll... beat their asses.
They win.
Win it with the
handedly.
Double drop kick.
Handedly.
Double drop kick is a great finisher.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a drop kick, but we're both drop kicking at the same time.
That's four boots in your face
just
one
time.
Can
you imagine sobering yourself up enough to get the timing down, be able to hit that thing at the same time.
Yeah, like, that's the real impressive part here.
These guys must have been pounding coffee, like slapping each other. Like, all right.
When you're thinking of how much cocaine.
Gotta get that double drop kick.
Whatever the hell else they were doing the night before and slip into the tinny boppers and the training bras.
And all the rock and roll that they listen to, clearly, like, that's got to be exhausting, too. These guys really got wells of energy they're digging deep into.
They love the rock and roll.
Moving on, we're going to the fourth member of what will soon be the Four Horsemen, Tully Blanchard.
Who that?
He's maybe the most just naturally douchey man who's ever lived. Just sleaze. Like, you look at him and, like, your initial instinct is like, this guy looks like a used car salesman or something. But, like, no, it's worse than that. He looks like the guy that sells the used car salesman his cocaine. Like, this guy's drug dealer to the used car salesman community.
And you're like, well, I'm interested in that car over there. And
I love
it. You're like, well, I can't show you that car. Well, no, I really am interested. No, just stay away from the trunk of that car.
He's cocky. He's just a jerk off. Like, and he talks some shit. Like, if he wasn't next to Ric Flair all the time, who, like, did everything he did a little bit better, this guy could have been world champ. He could have been world champ anywhere.
He could have.
It's kind of, he's the Scottie Pippen to Flair's Michael Jordan, I feel like.
Yeah.
You know, we like talking 90s Chicago Bulls.
We love the hoops.
That's why we're sitting here wearing our 90s Chicago Bulls throwback jerseys as we're recording this.
I got a three-peat shirt on under that.
Oh, that's like that one with the three championship rings?
Yeah, because I'm white, so I'll still wear a t-shirt under a jersey.
Yeah.
You know? I'm not just going to wear a jersey.
Sometimes
sans shirt.
I wear a shirt in the pool.
Well,
I gotta wear a shirt in the pool.
You want to be comfortable.
I get sensitive.
You want to be comfortable.
I get embarrassed.
Yeah, I don't want everybody looking at how good I look.
Tully, another obnoxious suit. He's looking great.
He's got one of the thickest necks in all of wrestling too.
Not looking so great is his longtime ballet baby doll.
Now, clearly, she had some kind of skin issues as a young lady.
I'm telling you, man.
But she's grown.
Back in the 1980s, one thing wrestling's doing a lot better these days. Quality of that trim, baby. That trim out there is looking a lot better these days than it did back then.
Agree to disagree. Enjoyed this chubby high 6, low 7 being presented as a 10 on my TV screen.
This is not a local television station, Matt. This is national. This is the super station. This chick looks like she should be like in a local ad for a pool supply store or something.
Yeah.
She's out there getting trotted.
She looked gorgeous.
She comes out later and she's got another little segment. She's just built like a garbage can.
Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet. We're not there yet.
Move on to another promo with NWA president Bob Geigel.
The Geigs?
I know.
President?
This is your shit you love. You love it when they bring
president
out some generic president.
Bob Geigel.
Some generic authority figure.
Let's make this shit real. Here's President Bob Geigel.
The guy is clearly not a performer. Really didn't pull him out of an office somewhere.
I know he's not a performer because of how he went on and on for 5 minutes about how Tully.
About 10 times the length of any match we've had so far.
Tully didn't want the I Quit match with the T.A. Magnum.
No, that's probably the most brutal match in wrestling. Yeah. Like,
and he already.
Something you just sign willy nilly.
He already beat him.
Mm hmm.
They went to a draw the match before.
It was Tully's last chance, and they went to a draw. I don't see why we're still talking about this.
Yeah. As champion, I don't have to beat you. You got to beat me.
And that's very smart. That's a Bobby Heenanism there. He was always quick to point that out.
Went 52 minutes.
That guy's the brain. He knows.
T.A. Magnum did not win. It's over. That's it. It's over and done with. And Geigel was saying, you know, this I Quit match, this is too much. This is too deadly. This is too much. I can't do it. This is too deadly.
This
is too much.
They got interviewing Bob Geigel.
He was a good guy. Ricky Stewart,
beige suit to tie to.
He was a good guy.
Think that guy's ever touched a boob before?
Oh, you kidding me?
He kind of looked like he'd never touched a boob before.
Oh, his 20s get him a long way at the strip club, just like any other, you know, young buck out there.
Oh, man, I bet 80s strip clubs were insane.
Oh.
There had to be no rules back then.
Oh, it's Thunderdome, man.
Just like all those girls looking like baby doll.
Ooh,
it's like every once in a while you get one rub you so hard, like
one of her
pimples pops.
Hey,
gets, a little trickle of pus on your shirt, but you don't care.
That's very graphic imagery.
I was having good times.
That's very graphic. But yeah, Bob Guigel goes on for 10 minutes to get a 30-second point across, and then after the 10 minutes, reiterates his point in the 30 seconds that he originally needed. But it was useful. I like it. Made it seem like a sport.
Absolutely.
Made it seem like a real thing. You know, hey, powers
made
the beast.
Like they
too bad.
Shook him out of bed, woke him up, and was like, hey, we need you for a few seconds.
Yeah. But then they kick it back to Tully, and he does something I like a lot, which is where he ducks T.A. Magnum, you know, being like...
Magnum T.A.
I'm sorry. Okay, I keep wanting to say T.N.A.
T.N.A.
That's a real problem for me.
Yeah.
Magnum T.A. Great name.
T.A. stand for
beautiful face.
Maybe Terry Allen, that might have been his name.
Yeah, could have been.
Magnum just because he had the nice mustache. It makes sense.
But Tully points out, you know, I'm ducking you, but this ain't my fault, buddy. You know, this is out of my hands now.
Oh, yeah, sure.
So you just need to get over it.
I wanted to fight you, but...
I can't.
Geigel says no.
Yeah, so get over
it. Oh, well.
That's a great heel move right there.
Moving on to our next match. We got jacked up, bearded, brownie, paper towel looking Billy Jack Haynes versus some scrub in a mask they're calling Black Cat. This is a pretty solid match.
Borderline 80s wrestling, that's racist. Because we need to point out that Black Cat is indeed an
African-American dude. Yeah, they could have just left the mask off and just called him Black Dude.
Yeah,
Billy Jack Haynes versus Black Dude.
Instead, they gave him a cat mask and were like, "Now you Black Cat."
Billy's yoked, man.
Oh,
this guy.
Billy looks great.
Wall of muscle.
Great.
You could tell that he was just like a couple months from going to WWF. Like if Vince had his eye on this guy.
If Dr. Death,
bring him in. If, WWF written all over him.
If Dr. Death were ever tall and in shape.
That would never happen.
Though. Well, if so, this is him.
He was pretty tall. Definitely would never be in shape.
I don't think he was all that tall. Mm. Either way.
So, solid little match here, because Billy Jack isn't just a big roided-up creep. He's working a smart match. He was. Got that big full Nelson finisher, so what's he doing? He's just pounding on this guy's neck and shoulders the whole time.
Just Orton-esque rest holds and over again.
Keep pounding on that neck and shoulders. You got to loosen him up, and then you're going to hit him with that full Nelson. He's going to have nowhere to go. He's going to be done, pal.
One of the longer squash matches. He'd hit a power move, and then bam, right into a chin lock.
There you go.
Power move,
rank on
chin lock,
just wrench
power
on
move,
neck.
Chin lock. So slam the back, work the neck, slam the back, work the neck. But they were quick to put over that, you know, he's got the full Nelson no one's getting out of. And they set it up. They set it up well. And I like he also did some kind of sweet karate-inspired chop.
Yeah, this guy, you know.
It was pretty cool.
He was trained in the dungeon.
Dungeon?
Yeah, he was trained up
Which
in that
dungeon?
Dungeon. You know, the one with Stu Hart had going on in Calgary, that shitty basement.
Stu Hart?
Weird hillbilly house that all those hundreds of wrestlers lived in. So this guy knows what he's doing.
I wonder if I'll talk about another Stu Hart later. Guy
in the crowd, serious black guy in a nice powder blue suit who just kept holding his finger up, scolding. I don't know who he was mad at, but he was...
I don't think I liked
him. I was watching him for a while. Like, I missed some of this match because I was watching this guy just wag his finger and get real serious about whatever
he was mad about. I kept
panning
the audience looking for that one guy, and apparently that was him, and I just missed him.
Nice suit.
Yeah.
Transition into
one of my favorite segments of the night.
Sitting across a glass table with a couple of cowboy boots on it.
Yeah.
Couple of cowboy boots on a glass table sounds like a euphemism for something, but no, that's just literally
really
what they had. He's talking to Dusty Rhodes' doctor. Interviewing him about this big leg injury we've been hearing.
Are you talking about Dr. Joseph Aswani?
He's got a name?
Yeah.
He's
a real doctor.
You took some good notes there.
I know for a fact the brain, he had a bad case of strep throat.
Uh-huh.
About 87 or so. And he went and saw Dr. Joseph Aswani.
Oh, so this guy does bone breakage and designs...
Oh, he does it all.
...new sorts of... prosthetic cowboy boots, and also he's just a general practitioner.
He does it all. He does it all.
I'd like to put him up against a doctoring competition with Ric Flair's dad.
He's good, but he wouldn't win that.
Not that good. Okay, that makes sense.
I want to point something out here.
Oh, I'm all ears.
And I'm
yeah.
thinking what would eventually become the Horseman kind of got a bad rap.
Why do you say that?
Because Dusty...
Yeah.
From what I can tell, is living the same life. He's telling everybody, oh, son of a plumber.
He's got private doctors. They're
He's got private
new cowboy
doctors.
Boots.
I got this doctor
so is this
on my
cowboy
TV.
Cowboy boot regulation? Like,
no,
what's the
no,
deal with
I'm
this?
I'm going to get to that. But I got this doctor on my TV telling me about this new thing that they've invented called an Aircast.
Oh,
have you heard about
yeah,
these?
These
Aircast.
Well, until Dr. What's his name?
Dr. Joseph Atswani.
Yeah, until Dr. Joseph Atswani was telling me about this Aircast and how it's going to fit into this new fancy cowboy boot.
And I'm thinking,
this is how Dusty Rhodes is going to be able to come back so soon from this broken leg.
And Shivani's talking to me, you know, oh, Dusty, he gets these are his boots here. He gets them from the Austin Hall Boot Company in El Paso, Texas.
Yeah.
And then points out, yeah, this boot here from those people. Yeah, well, a little bit more of that 80s, that's racist wrestling.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, I think we know what Shivani meant by those people.
Nobody's perfect.
But either way, as you alluded to,
1980s wrestling, less of all.
Yeah,
these people.
They don't care.
Not good people a lot of times.
They make this special boot for Dusty, different than his normal cowboy boot.
Once again, this little segment putting over this boot lasts about 5 or 6 times longer than any of these matches on the show.
It's like a steel reinforced boot, like a steel toe construction boot, and they're talking about it like it's no big deal. And here I am thinking to myself, like, am I the only person that sees, like, this is cheating?
What's going to happen when Ric Flair gets kicked in the head with this thing? He's going to get CTE, my man.
Oh, man.
I'm lucky if he survives this match.
I'm over it. I don't want to talk about it anymore. Next segment.
They're doing a good job of putting over this match, making a big deal about Dusty's leg. So we move on.
Oh, I'd like to point out real quick, it really dawned on me in that segment. I got to go back to this. This is too important. How much Tony Schiavone in that segment looked like Brian Doyle Murray in Caddyshack.
Oh, yeah, I could see that. A lot. Definitely.
Yeah. He should have just been working a gimmick where all throughout the live show, he's yelling at kids to pick up trash.
Unfortunately, he was waiting until the cameras stopped rolling to do that.
No, give us that on screen.
Made it a character thing.
Give us that on screen. Hey, kid, pick that up.
Move on to another squash. We got Magnum TA, the aforementioned guy feuding with Tully Blanchard. This is the fastest match on the card.
He
kills Keith Eric. It's basically the only tackle, drop down, leapfrog, hits you with my fucking finish. We go to the showers.
The only note I have on this match is over.
Sure was.
Yeah.
Moving on to an interview with superstar Billy Graham.
Oh, yeah.
Kind of a slipping down the backside superstar Billy Graham.
Yeah, looking real weird.
Not looking like that quote-unquote superstar that he was in the 70s.
No.
Starting to look more like a guy maybe hanging on a little bit too long.
He kind of looked like the...
Still real jacked, baby. Looking real jacked, brother.
He looked like the dad from that Custom County Choppers show a couple years ago.
Oh, I'm familiar with how that dad looks.
Where it's like, you're a little old to be taking all those steroids, sir.
You're just beat red. Like, you either need to get some blood pressure medication or maybe not lay out in the sun for 6 hours every day.
Yeah, a little Lisinopril. Not going to hurt you, man.
Thing that I took away from this most is that Paul Jones, you know, he's coming out, he's confronting superstar Billy Graham on behalf of Abby the Butcher. This guy had some heat. Like, he was nuclear. He's not even that good of a manager. That just shows you how awesome managers are, how good they work. Like, all you gotta do is come out there and be like, yeah, I'm a bad guy manager, like, I'm a coward who can't wrestle, but I'm still gonna interfere, and everybody's gonna hate it. They're gonna hate it so bad.
He had a great heel bit, and I always make sure to look, because as a fan of the bad guys,
classic
the heels,
heel shit.
I look
is what
for
we
just
are about.
Good little stupid shit that gets the point across that you're the bad guy, and he's getting in an argument with Billy Graham. It's clearly Graham's turn to talk.
Mm-hmm.
He takes the mic, tucks it under his arm,
also wearing a ruffled tuxedo shirt. It's another one. Another one.
Takes the mic, tucks it under his arm, and turns away from Billy. You know, presenting Billy his back.
Petulant little
and
child.
And gives him the shut up, I'm talking. That's big.
That's good.
That's big stuff.
That's.
I also like the 12-year-old. I like the 12-year-old girl in the audience that was holding up a sign that says, Billy, I want your shirt. Because it was a pink tie-dyed shirt.
Yeah, he did wear a lot of tie-dye. I don't think it would fit her. She should have thought that through better.
Hey, wear like a sleep shirt.
So this is all supposed to be a big lead up into an arm wrestling competition between real jacked baby Billy Graham and
a big
famous
fat slot.
Badass Abdullah the Butcher. Full-on gunt on this guy. He's got that fupa tucked into his pants, like, not looking great. He knows he's not going to win this arm wrestling match.
He just starts beating
the shit out of Billy Graham instead of doing an arm wrestling thing. That was smart.
You were talking about Tony Zane's boobs earlier.
Yeah, uh-huh.
How about Abby's side boobs?
Oh, yeah, these things.
Those are world famous.
Kind of like those giant pancakes that Uncle Buck would make with the snow shovels and hit movie Uncle Buck.
That's disgusting.
Put two of those giant pancakes on your chest
imagery.
And you got Abby's titties right there, brother.
Oof.
So this was just a terrible just little
garbage. It looked like they're wrestling in thick mud.
Oh man,
they're barely moving.
Billy Graham's so weak, so slow, so clumsy. Everything he does looks like garbage. You can't even strangle Abby with a cord and make it look real.
No. Nothing about this
God
match looked
good.
God
bless the Barbarian for coming out and interrupting this match and putting an end to it. Like
sacrificing himself with those two top rope headbutts.
Couple of top rope headbutts to the superstar.
Just give us something.
They all start laying into him. Paul Jones with his cane, Abby and Barbarian with the stomps. Then we get a group of good guys run out to save him.
I don't know the product well enough. Were those guys anybody in particular? Three or four jobbers that were
just
like,
some guys who showed up in wrestling tights.
Billy Graham, a nice man. You leave him alone.
Absolutely. Move on to what I thought was the best match of the evening. Got some time.
Oh, they had some time.
Got Pez Watley versus Benny Trailer. Benny Trailer, great jobber, loved him. This guy got zero offense, but he was still struggling enough to where he drew this match out for a few minutes. He's always trying to fight out of holds, always trying
to
get some offense in there, but Pez Watley just has his number. He's a better dude. Nobody is in shape but the main eventers down here in the South. Like, it really makes those main eventers who actually are in good shape look like much bigger deals than like WWF where everybody's just jacked, so really nobody's jacked. If you catch my drift?
Nobody. No one at all.
So more body part working in here. Trailer's real consistent with his selling. Like, he's not using that injured body part. And eventually you get a big jump in headbutt. Pez Watley wins, knocks him out, head-on-head crack. And it's the one big jump in move of the match. And it ends the match, actually. Different from today's wrestling where you get 200 jump in moves in the first 2 minutes
least.
And nothing happens. Nobody cares. It was really in this match where I started realizing that David Crockett was a character that Christopher Guest would play in one of his mockumentaries.
Oh, that's fair. Yeah. That's very fair.
He's terrible at commentary.
Well, here's the thing.
Good move.
They couldn't have been more checked out on like the first 5 minutes of that match.
Hey, good move.
Where they were talking about people's Stu and Helen's 52nd wedding anniversary.
Wow, that's nice.
And how you can write
You
can write in if it's your 50th wedding anniversary.
You want to talk to your wrestler's favorite wrestler,
write
into this address too.
They'll write you back.
We'll get them. Didn't say that. They said they'll get it.
That's true.
I don't see any of these guys fucking answering fan mail.
I don't think a lot of them
could
write.
Maybe Shivani had to write some stuff and sign their names after he clocked out at the end of the night.
Hey, little kid.
At one point, David Crockett stopped just saying good move after everything and specified a little bit more. Good drop kick.
Yeah.
And I was like, this commentary's starting to come around. It's getting a little bit better.
You can tell when he's engaged and when he's not. He makes it very evident.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One point it was weird. Was it Benny Trailer?
Benny Trailer.
He was in a submission hold and he tapped out. But this is before the UFC made tapping out a thing. So that was real weird. Like, it didn't mean anything.
Yeah, no.
It's weird to see that guy sitting in a hold tapping and nobody even reacted to it.
Yeah.
Pez Watley seemed like a solid wrestler. Looks like a nice dad. Just looks like somebody's nice dad.
He went on to become.
I enjoy this match. You're poo pooing it. I think they did good.
He went on to become a world famous jobber, Pez Watley.
Okay. Yeah, it makes sense. He's basically two steps away from being a jobber here. He seems real. Real sound, like he'd be good at that.
I want to see him wrestle under a mask or something. I don't know.
That makes sense.
We'll probably get back to him somewhere down the line.
Oh, I can't wait for that. That's going to be fun for us. Moving on to a promo, J.J. Dillon brings another one of his guys out.
Some
Black
good
Bart.
Stuff. Killing it.
You think he's
killing it?
Good job here. You like this?
He's my pick to click.
Yeah, solid. Just screaming 80s promo.
Yes.
Just
the
like
best
just
one
screaming.
Of the night.
He's looking directly into the camera.
Yeah. They're hyping. I don't even know who the hell he's wrestling. They're having the rope match. Who was it against? It was another cowboy.
It doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't matter.
What matters is when he starts beating himself in the head with that cowbell at the end of his promo.
He's like, we're going to have this match. I'm going to wrap this rope around you. If I get this bell, you could use it on your noggin.
He didn't say one word that wasn't
use it in your guts.
Yeah.
And then he just starts hitting himself in the head with a cowbell. Mm-hmm. And then like JJ, there's some stipulation where if like Black Bart gets beat, then the other dude gets to fight JJ in a bull rope match for five minutes.
That'll be nice.
And JJ tries to like talk about it, and Black Bart just yells at him.
Hey, I'm hollering here.
He's just like, no, It's never going to happen. Yeah. No.
Manager is very versatile. But some guys just don't need a manager. No, Black Bart should be out there stomping around by himself, just screaming at everybody.
He just needs to be off the hinges, unleashed.
We move into a little rundown of Starrcade.
Oh, God.
I really enjoy these things.
With Jimmy Crockett?
The WWF presentation. Oh. Where we shoot over to the whatever center with Mean Gene Okerlund.
There's a real
run it down.
Slick, glossy package.
That would get me hyped up for these pay-per-views.
We're showing you the greatest hits.
Yeah, these guys just bring out Jim Crockett Jr., and they're still standing in the same place they always sit, and they're just blandly talking about what's going to come up.
Hey, do y'all like wrestling?
You need some salesmanship, and it is not here. It's not going on here.
I want to talk to you about wrestling matches.
Okay, I want to tell you about, 80s, classic 80s racism. 80s wrestling racism.
Yeah, here it comes.
One of the matches
talk
we're hyping
about
up.
It.
A
talk
Mexican death match.
A Mexican death match?
There's more stipulations. It's not just a Mexican death match.
Okay, because I'm familiar.
A big title on the line here.
Ooh, what?
Big
Like a
Big
belt,
prize.
like a champion,
this
like a
match
strap.
Is going to be for quote unquote Manny Fernandez's sombrero.
His gorgeous sombrero.
Say it with me. That's racist.
That is racist, and they've been leading up all night to it. What's going to be the big racist moment? That was
there. It is Mexican death there match for a sombrero. We get some more Tully and Magnum footage. Magnum's out there with Baby Doll.
Oh, this was another one of my favorite parts of the night.
We go from some nice 80s racism to some nice 80s sexism, wherein Magnum T.A. grabs Baby Doll, commits sexual assault on her, tries to tear her dress off.
While Dave Crockett just gets a big boner.
She likes it. She likes it. That was the only good thing he did the entire episode.
He loved watching that strong man force himself on that.
She likes it as that poor woman was getting a tongue shoved down her throat.
Yeah.
The audience has yet to pick up on the idea that rape is a bad thing, so they're cheering their heads off for their big rapey hero, Magnum T.A. Tully, the real hero in this scenario, if you ask me, comes out, just starts wailing on Magnum again.
Hey, that's my high six, low seven woman. You can't just inflict your will upon her. Yeah.
Hands off my garbage can, girlfriend.
And then that jerk Dave Crockett with his boner jumps on Tully's back to try to break it up.
They're stacking the deck against this guy. Garbage. It's pathetic. Doing a really good job of promoting this big I Quit steel cage match that apparently we're not going to have at Starrcade, but they're still promoting it, which is weird.
Yeah, why are you going to get my guy, Mr. Geigel, out there telling me it's not going to happen? And then that pencil neck dweeb, Jim Crockett, comes out and he's like, no, you signed a contract
a
long time ago.
And I'm plot gonna, twist. The, I'm ma- just gonna, the match is happening.
You signed a contract a long time ago, and I'm just going to put whatever I want on it now.
NWA commission. Quit playing games with my heart,
I'm going to... Abusive power. Abusive power.
Springing off that, we get another Tully segment, because he's in a squash match versus a man named Denny Brown.
Denny Brown looked good. Had a nice jobber look.
These guys were kind of in shape, but you could tell that they still really like beer.
DB on the boots.
Getting your little initials on your boots is a nice touch. To let them
especially
know, like, hey,
if they could mean douchebag.
I'm a jobber, but I'm a professional jobber. I'll be back jobbing again soon. You'll see me again.
You'll hear this name one more time.
At one point, Tony Schiavone had a weird commentary thing where he was, look at Tully Blanchard, so mad he's white.
Yeah,
like that's
that
a thing,
was a
Tony. Like
comment.
People turn white when they get they turn red when they get really mad. What the fuck are you talking about, brother?
He got so mad, all the color left his face is what he tried
to
claim.
That's what happens when you get scared.
That doesn't make a whole lot of sense.
If you're Scooby and Shaggy and you see a ghost, that's when you turn white.
But once again, Dave Crockett got a boner.
You get that AIDS test back, and it's positive for AIDS. Then you turn white. If you get a pregnancy test back, and it's pregnant with someone else's baby, that's when you get red. You turn angry.
Splice a little of TLC's Waterfalls in right here, just underneath as we talk about this.
Do they tell you
stuff.
Who the dad is in a pregnancy test? I don't understand how biology works.
But that Dave Crockett had a big boner for Tully jumping that man before the bell. He apparently just loves assault. Any kind of assault just really gets his motor running.
You know, make your living in the pro wrestling and business. Loving assault is not a bad thing to love, I'd say.
And it's very evident in this match something Mr. Dave Crockett does, which is just awful and annoying. When he's really excited about something, he does like the, watch this, like you're watching a movie or a TV show with somebody that's seen it already, and they're like, this part right here. And it's like,
this is the best part.
Oh, you know he's going to do the clothesline.
Oh, no, wait, he does it later.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, so Dave Crockett,
we're still
awful.
Deep in horseman territory here, because we go from this squash match that Tully wins with a slingshot suplex, which I thought was a cool finish.
It always was.
Into Arn and Ole talking again, just yelling. Back to them talking.
Ole yelling about injustice.
Oh, yeah, and he's right, because these guys are getting screwed right and left in the build-up to Starrcade.
Yep.
In my heart, these heels are right, they're righteous, and they need to take a goddamn baseball bat to some of these NWA commissioner guys, because they're getting screwed right and left.
And finally, a voice of reason, Arn points out something that bothered me almost 20 minutes ago.
Oh, no.
Arn isn't a fan of Dusty's new boot.
No, yeah,
he says,
right?
Steel enforced, and he brings up a great point. He says, if somebody breaks my arm, can Ole tape a ball pin hammer to it?
No. They gonna let him wrestle in his pinky ring, just...
Yeah.
Putting big old pinky ring shaped dents in people's foreheads?
No.
But
this guy gets a steel boot. Whatever.
We move into the segment of the show now that's all about the Russians.
Yeah. A
trio of Russians. Yeah. Ivan Koloff, Nikita Koloff, the Russian Nightmare, and very really young little...
really dragged here.
Crusher Khrushchev, Barry Darso. He's not trying to act. The other two, at least, are trying accents to pretend they're Russian.
They're doing a Russian bit, and he's just like, hey, I'm from Russia.
Barry Darso, I put on the Russia outfit, now I'm Russian too now.
How y'all doing? I'm from Russia.
Nikita Koloff starts it off, a squash match versus Mac Jeffers. Nikita Koloff, this guy's just, more than anybody on this show, a solid wall of muscle. Like,
yeah.
Hard muscle.
He looked good. I liked this little squash match.
He was great. It's Russian the, sickle, that big mean
just
clothesline.
Beast, like, yeah. You put get this guy over. I mean, this is, yeah.
Put this guy against a big, like, patriotic good guy. You could get a run against Hulk Hogan with this guy back in the 80s.
Oh, right.
Would have been so much money. So much money.
So much.
But here he's just kind of mid-card stuff.
Yep.
They go into a promo, which is nice when you get the little interview segment right next to the match. You can go back and forth from the ring to the... Makes it easy to challenge people for like segments to break down, for it to seem chaotic. Nikita's selling that accent. From what I understand, he pretended like he was Russian 24/7, no matter who he was with.
Yeah,
in a room with him, and he'd still be talking like a Russian, like
that's
an insane person.
You can't understand him at all.
No, he's not good at
accent.
So maybe Barry Darso not trying one as Crusher Khrushchev was a little bit of a kindness to us. Real racist moment here.
Oh boy,
when Darso starts talking, yelling about
them
the
Road Warriors.
Warriors. Yeah, what did he say?
But they weren't on the show. Why is that?
Oh yeah, because
that's because they were
over in the
fighting
Orient.
A bunch of 5'10" Japs.
Jesus Christ!
Oh God!
You could just say stuff like that.
How was any of this
national
okay?
television?
Oh, man. What a different time.
Yeah, either way, I think Ivan Koloff's really ugly. I like him.
I mean, but he raises a good point. I mean, they were probably beating a bunch of smaller Japanese guys. He just didn't say it the right way. But
sure.
It's a good point.
Whipping those.
It's a good point.
Little Japs.
Nope. Don't do it.
Somebody's got to get revenge. You see what happened in World War II, man?
No, I wasn't
those
alive.
Those little fuckers.
I wasn't alive.
Bombing Pearl Harbor.
Oh, Pearl Harbor, yeah.
What were they thinking?
I learned about that last week.
They probably needed a good, like, 10 or 12 more years of getting their asses beat by the Road Warriors before we were square on that deal.
Yeah.
Got my eye on you, Japan.
You know, that's all right.
So, yeah, Ivan's old and grizzled. Much better Russian guy than Nikolai Volkov, I thought. They got better Russians down south than they got Russians up north.
Yeah, these ones looked crazed and looked like they trained by fighting bears, you know.
Which
they seemed like threats. That was the thing. Nikolai Koloff, we should probably do 80s, like top three for our three count, like top three, like 80s heels that were just garbage that you never believed in. We're never
had,
a threat.
And he was singing the national definitely anthem, definitely be one. And then nothing.
Like, he's like, there was never a point in my life where I was like, ooh, this scary guy might win a match. Like,
so yeah, man. From match to promo, back to match. It's just a few short steps away. This is such a tiny TV studio. We get Ivan and the Crusher versus Ricky Reeves and Jerry Garmin.
Jerry Garmin.
This is just a real boring, real short squash.
Yeah, real boring.
So bad that David Crockett's commentary gets worse than it's been the entire match.
Yeah, a lot of shitty power moves.
So much dead air. One point, God, Tony made some sort of quip and Crockett was just, he just goes, ho, ho, ho. Pregnant pause. Pregnant pause, pregnant pause, and then follows it up with, that is true. Literally, it was
biting.
Like 8-9 segments of just dead air there.
Biting commentary.
He starts trying to change the subject. You watch these men. Pregnant pause.
Yeah, yeah, pregnant, I know exactly pause, what you're talking about.
Follows it up with nothing. Classic heel shit. You get some Ivan Koloff choking some guy with the tag rope, which I like. That
oh, that's
tag
always
rope
a nice
you got to hold on to in order for the tag to be
10,
legal.
12 inches of thread.
Tag's not legal if you're not holding on to that thing.
Yeah.
It's out there. Why not choke people with it?
Rules are rules, man.
Now we're moving into the real low point of, I think, not just this episode.
The best part of the night.
The 1980s is a decade.
You're talking about the best part of the night. I think you misworded this.
Oh, Jesus Christ. We got the Boogie Woogie Man, Jimmy Valiant.
Oh, baby.
You don't know him. He's just
the greatest wrestler.
Just
ever.
A hobo on psychedelics.
You mean the greatest wrestler ever.
He's wrestling a jobber named Jimmy Black, who's just real
baby.
Dumb looking. Like, this guy's just ghostly white skin and his powdered blue tights. Like, he looks like a picture of a pro wrestler that got, like, faded from the sun. A shock of red hair, too, to top it off.
I can't even listen to you because I'm thinking about how much I love Jimmy Valiant right
really?
Now. Oh, man.
I was more focused on Jimmy Black.
No.
Jimmy. That looked like the Pillsbury Doughboy got cast as Malachi in Children of the Corn. Like, he was dumb looking.
Jimmy Valiant is everything DDP wanted to be and couldn't be.
Oh, yeah. Like,
all hype.
There was that brief period
all
where
hype.
DDP lost all his money and was homeless. Like, I feel like you've, like, combined that with just, like, drugs, just like psychedelic drugs.
God, this guy's
just like
it.
10 or 12 pounds of caveman hair.
Yeah,
you get Jimmy Valiant.
Jimmy Black, though, back to you, his pale ass skin. He did have some nice tights. I like the like short tights with suspenders, whatever
kind of
look.
Of a singlet.
It's not like totally a singlet because like went too low or something. It was weird looking.
It was weird looking.
Yeah.
But this match isn't even about the match.
But yeah, let's talk about my guy
getting
here.
Getting back into this cross-dressing thing.
Jimmy Valiant's personal crying game.
Out of context, 8 seconds we got at the very beginning
baby.
Of the
all
show.
All coming back.
Comes
yeah.
back.
You've waited, you know, an hour and 5 minutes for this point right here.
And did the match not even end? It just gets interrupted by this woman, this
no,
quote-unquote woman?
No, it ends. excuse me. The woman runs in. Sneaks up on Jimmy Valiant, kisses him, and Jimmy's like, oh, somebody stop that.
Yeah, this
somebody stop that woman. Somebody stop that lady.
6'10".
Oh, stop that lady. Ooh, stop that lady.
300 pounds of muscle.
Yeah.
She's got a wig.
And so he's chasing her into the ropes,
wig
this
and
that.
Clothes, so the dumbass announcers are just selling it like they really think it's a woman.
Yeah.
Like everybody's just acting like they really think
that. And
it's
I
a
tell
woman.
You what, they did a great job. I marked out and was like, I don't know, is that a woman? Is that just a really big woman?
It was so bad.
No, it was really good.
Except afterwards.
So Jimmy Black sticks his head in the ropes at some point, and then the beautiful young lady has a monster right hand.
So yeah, she comes out and smooches Jimmy Valiant
in
his hobo mouth.
And then runs out the ring. And
he's enamored instantly.
Yeah.
Like Pepe Le Pew and style. Then, like he's got cartoon hearts pumping in his eyeballs.
God, so
this
good.
Woman is so
it's
beautiful.
So good.
He's got such a powerful sexual energy about
doing
her.
Doing it so right. So then she knocks Jimmy Black clean the fuck out.
Oh,
and then,
she did.
Yeah.
I
and
that.
Then Jimmy Valiant pins him.
Goes
and he's like, whoa. Somebody stop that. Stop
you
that
know
lady.
Why that woman was able to knock him out
stop
so easily to punch.
Because she's probably like a trained boxer or something.
Well, under that wig. I kind of Googled this to see where this fucking thing was going. No. That's Hands of Stone. Oh. Ronnie Garvin dressed up as that woman.
Oh, I wanted
Man's
to
got
let
hands
this...
of stone. No Why'd wonder you gotta... he knocked him out.
You're that dick kid who had to tell kids that Santa Claus wasn't real. You know, I wanted to watch this play out. There was a part of me that believed maybe it was a woman.
Santa Claus isn't real?
Maybe it was like a Nicole Bass type thing.
I mean, you would
God rest her
been
soul.
Right at home doing commentary next to Tony Schiavone in 1980.
Schiavone and I could have been killing it.
A couple of clueless
like,
putzes.
Opportunity missed on
no
Dave
idea
Crockett.
What's going
it should
on.
Have been Schiavone and I out there. I, you know, just like, oh, man.
Yeah.
You talk about our looker, Schiavone.
Promo of the night, maybe the Bart promo from earlier, but probably this Jimmy Valiant promo, and he walks over to the interview spot because
he's got
afterwards.
The lines.
He's
got
just
the lines.
Eyes are bugging
well,
out of his head.
Well, he chases off Jim Cornette first.
Oh, Jim Cornette in his canary yellow
Jim Cornette
suit,
comes out there doing the Jim Cornette.
Green tie. He
and,
looks,
like, he's young AF in this.
He looks terrible.
Yeah. Jim Cornette.
Big-ass dumb glasses of his. It just looks like an 8-year-old who recently joined the army. Like, what are they? I think he still wears those fucking glasses.
Oh, yeah, he does.
It's probably the same pair.
You can catch him on Anthem Wrestling.
Sure, he's very frugal.
Check him out on Anthem.
So, yeah, he's fired up. He's yelling about the Midnight Express or whatever. And he gets ran off by Jimmy Valiant, who then just.
Who nobody cared about
sells
ever.
Sells the fuck out of the idea that he's in love with Jimmy Garvin in a wig. Just seriously in love.
Yeah.
He wants to find this woman. He wants to make sweet love to her. He wants to marry her.
Do you got some of the highlights in there? Because
no.
I got them, pal.
You were writing down specific things he said.
Oh, it was one of my favorite promos ever.
Okay. Well, hit us with some good lines.
He's like, oh, daddy. Oh, where's that old lady at, brother? She's the toughest broad I've ever seen in my life. Oh, that she's all mine, baby. She's all mine. That lady's street people. That lady's down, baby.
Sure is.
After he calls her street people and says that she's down, they show that same 12-year-old girl again holding up a sign that says, I love Boogie Woogie
Boogie
Man.
Boogie Woogie Man, yeah, I saw that sign. She's seems like all the old men. She brought a sign for Boogie Woogie Man, a sign for the superstar. Like,
but unfortunately for that young lady,
one of these hot young rock and roll expresses for her.
The Boogie Woogie Man.
She likes a little salt and pepper.
Boogie Woogie Man loves the street ladies.
Yeah, he's not going for these young little teeny boppers. He wants a burly street lady.
Yeah, in the full sweater.
So that was the main event, that promo.
Ladies, street people.
The show's over now. Jimmy Valiant calling that woman street people and saying that he loves her.
You know, I was quick.
That's your big finish.
I was quick to call this finish. Like, leading up to it, I was like, oh, they're going with the crush doink finish, which I think we can just start calling things the crush
doink
finish.
Finish,
when it's, you know, bullshit awful. And it's I see Jimmy Valiant, I'm like, oh, here we go, it's crush doink. And then this all plays out, and then street people, and the ladies down, baby. And, man, you talking about turning chicken shit into chicken salad.
Maybe still like a little bit of chicken shit mixed in there, but Jimmy Valiant doesn't
That's
care.
Just because, yeah, that's because Jimmy's got salmonella.
He's ate shit before, and he'll eat shit again.
Yeah, he's not above that.
Eating out of dumpsters, it's bound to happen.
He's not above it.
So, I feel like overall that was a pretty fun show. I'm pumped to watch Starrcade. Like, it's getting me excited for Starrcade. Yeah. The Gathering.
Yeah, did you keep thinking about the Juggalos as well?
I kept being like, I didn't even know that ICP was a band back then.
Woop,
like,
woop.
It's going to give you like a little
woop, woop.
8 and 9-year-old Shaggy, Too Dope, and Violent J showing up at a Starrcade 88. Woop, woop. The Gathering.
I want Jim Crockett saying to me, we got Magnum TA versus Tully Blanchard in an I Quit Steel Cage match. Ooh. Whoop, whoop.
Magnum, how the hell do they work?
Whoop, whoop.
Yeah. So that's it for the show. Let's get ready, come back a little bit, and do some more discussion about 80s pro wrestling in the format of a 3-count.
Whoop, whoop, whoop.
Which is a list, but trademarked 3-count.
Yeah, we came up with
Nobody else used that. We came up with it.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
Whoa, totally way chill, California.
Yo,
cool muscle dude, Stingman.
Like Sting, like where on his
like
feet?
Ruse, dude.
Ruse. Shoes for your feet, pockets for your stuff.
start your lunch. I'll be right back.
Well, I went down to school, and who did I see?
Peter Pan, Peter Butterfinger.
Well, the kids were all eating that peanutty treat.
Peter Pan tastes so peanutty because it's made from the best peanuts in the world.
Eat some peanut butter every time you can. Only if it's Peter Pan.
We are back at it
back
with
here.
Our brand spanking new original segment.
Damn.
Something we've come up with. No one else has it. I'm talking about the three count.
So last week, we made a big deal of going to one of the most obvious ones, doing our favorite 80s wrestlers.
Just, yo.
Burning through all our hot material the first week. Not very smart, probably, but nice little getting to know you, getting to know our predilections.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to flip that script a little bit this week and change it around. Favorite 80s wrestlers, not now, childhood favorites. Who did you like back when you were a kid?
Yeah.
You got to remember, like, kids are stupid. That's like the one main thing about kids. Is
not me.
Dumb as fucking rocks.
Not
like,
me.
They don't know. And they think they're not stupid, which makes them even stupider.
No, I know I wasn't.
I'm pretty sure you were stupid. I've seen some of your yearbook pictures. Like,
I'm like the Bobby the Brain of kids.
Yeah, Bobby the Brain with a fucking like little rat mustache.
You know what? You know what?
Blonde tipped hair.
It was grown out either way. You know what my nickname was when I was a little child?
Who gave you this nickname?
My mother.
Oh, okay.
You want to guess?
Shaggy Two Dope?
Nope. That'd be a pretty cool name, though.
Pretty cool.
I wish it was.
What was it?
The Weasel. Just like Pauly Shore.
This predated.
And Bobby the Brain.
Predated
Heenan.
Pauly Shore's comedy career, though. So
yeah.
It must have been a Bobby Heenan reference that she was shooting for.
Must have.
Let's jump right in it. We need to talk about what you liked back when Little Weasel was watching wrestling. Who was his guys? Who was his main guys, my man?
One of my guys was one of the Weasel's guys.
Number three, member of the Heenan family.
Yeah.
Lay it on me.
I'm going with Kurt Hennig.
Oh,
Mr. Perfect.
Mr. Perfect, Kurt Hennig.
Now you got to get
No second N. It's not Henning. All you idiots are always calling him Henning. His name was goddamn Kurt Hennig.
Hennig. It's a hard G. Hennig.
What do you like about this guy? Not to like about this guy?
You know, and I want to bump this out a little bit. If you're just joining us, we've decided 80s pro wrestling ends in about 93.
Oh, it's the NBA Jam rule.
Yeah, it's the NBA Jam rule.
Another couple years of each decade. It bleeds over.
Bleeds over.
You could talk a little bit about something going on 91, 92 if you want to. Nothing post-Raw.
No, nothing
post-Raw. Post-NBA Jam, post-Raw. It's off the table.
So
it's in the penalty box. It's
80,
under that glass table where Jimmy Valiant was jerking off famously while a hooker shit on it.
Oh, I'm telling you, I could have rode with that guy. Mm. I could have traveled with him.
You guys would have had a lot of late nights.
We would have had a cool thing going.
Summer nights.
Cool thing going. But Mr. Perfect, my wheelhouse is about 88 to 92, 93. That's where I really started.
That's
where
prime.
I found wrestling. You know,
prime
that's where
Perfect.
I found wrestling. And Mr. Perfect, man, like, I didn't understand what it was to be the bad guy, to be the heel, but I dug this guy.
Okay.
He presented himself as being better than everybody else.
Which he was.
Which is like, as a young kid, I'm like, why wouldn't you want to be better than everybody else?
Well, I mean,
if you dub yourself literally perfect.
Yeah.
What else is there?
To quote America's greatest poet, Kid Rock,
they
say I'm cocky. And I say, what? It's not bragging if something, Kid Rock backs it up.
Find West Coast pussy for my Detroit players.
Wait, is that just you're telling Jimmy Valiant? Is this you guys talking after?
Yeah, no,
after,
this is
after
us after. Yeah, this is us after a match. But Perfect was the guy. He was cool. The whole towel thing, and I can't tell you how many days I spent perfecting that swat your own spit gum out of the air.
Yeah, I've seen you swat your gum.
But I still do it.
Still
God
do
damn
all
it!
The
I
time.
Still do it.
I've seen you get that in like little girls' hair.
Yep.
I've seen you hit like handicapped people in the eye.
Bitches had it coming.
Probably.
Yeah. But I thank you, the late, great Mr. Perfect.
He's a great pick. It's a quality choice for a young kid to pick up on the talent of a Mr. Perfect. I'm going to keep rolling that in and take it next to my number three pick, another guy who totally holds up, totally is still great when you look at back at him today. Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
Ooh.
Okay, yeah, no. So I don't know why. I liked Brutus the Barber Beefcake a lot when I was a kid.
It was the scissoring motion, man.
Oh, you know.
You weren't doing that as a just.
Have you been looking at my Google search history? What are you?
Yeah.
You know what I'm into.
Oh, pal, me and Jimmy Vallant, no.
Thought I had all that stuff deleted.
Nope.
We so, yeah, out. Brutus Beefcake. I was too young to pick up on the whole, like, see-through net tight, like, bow-tied Chippendale dancer beefcake thing he had going on. Like,
yeah, it was for the ladies.
I didn't know how homoerotic he was. I was just like, this guy's a barber. This guy's cutting people's hair after he wins matches, which is cool. I think what I like most is he finished these matches with the sleeper hold, and then he'd cut the guy's hair while they were asleep. And when you're a kid, there's nothing cooler than the goddamn sleeper hold, because, like you said about Santa earlier, you figure out Santa's not real, you figure out magic isn't real.
Yeah.
The sleeper hold actually works.
Was real.
Like, you find could, out that's real, you could really just put
could
somebody
choke
to sleep.
A man out, yeah.
And, like, back in the day, like, they used to be out, those, you know, do you know where your kids are? Sort of like hyped up news reports they do on the evening news all the time. They're always talking about these kids playing the knockout game where they're choking each other out, and like you know, kids are getting brain damage, people are dying, and usually those things are bullshit. Like, it's just like, oh, come on, you just fucking sit. But no, we were knocking each other out with the sleeper holds when we were kids, like right and left, like just like wrestling matches on the trampoline. We'd be right and left just putting each other to bed, man.
Raise his arm. Did it drop that third time?
Absolutely.
Well, you better let go of the hold. You better let go of the hold.
And he's killed a bunch of his brain cells.
Now, everybody run home before one of the parents finds
out. We're only 8 years old. I could have been president probably if I didn't let Mike Westforth knock me out with a sleeper hold all those times.
Luckily, we were at Mark and Pam's house, and no trouble's going to come with
Mark and Pam were swingers. They weren't paying any attention to what you guys were doing.
No, they were worried about your wife.
Okay. So that's my number three, Brutus Beefcake. I'm sorry. I had negligible, questionable taste when I was an eight-year-old boy.
No, I enjoyed his career, too, as a young child.
Strutting and cutting.
You're right.
Strutting
and cutting. That's a great, that's good shit right there.
It rhymes. Yeah. It's what he really did. Nice little package.
He's a good dude. You know, he still cuts hair.
Is that true?
Yeah.
I didn't...
He was in town at a barber convention.
Wow.
Along with Mark Calloway for an Undertaker convention. We'll get to that some other time.
You're going to a lot of conventions.
I know people. I know people. They know things.
Busy
Let's
schedule.
Just put it that way.
You got enough time on that schedule to give us your number two?
I got enough for
a number two.
A number two. And this is very important to me because this laid the groundwork for one of my favorite wrestlers of all time. And I never realized maybe exactly why I liked him. And it just continued down the road. I'm talking about the Rockers.
Okay, Shawn Michaels, Marty Jannetty.
Marty Jannetty.
I'm going to allow this, you know.
I know, they came in 88 and then like
no, I'm not saying timelines.
89.
I'm feeling like you're burning through too many lists here. We're going to do tag teams later on. We got to do separate tag team lists later
on. I know, but like these were my guys here, and it was for a big reason.
I loved these guys.
I never liked Bret Hart.
No? Was it his dumb Canadian accent?
I don't know. He was just a...
You know.
You know how I like... You know how I like perfect for being a smarmy, better than you, whatever? Bret Hart was just Dudley Do-Right, Poindexter dork to me, even when he was a heel.
Pretty smarmy.
Nah, I never liked the guy. And these...
Well, I mean, he wasn't supposed to be smarmy. He's supposed to be a good guy for most of that
These
run.
Guys gave me somebody else to like.
Mm-hmm. It's like... The Rock and Roll Express.
Yeah. But what
better.
They were trying to
but
do.
Better, yeah. If like the guys actually were handsome, like, you know, don't get me wrong, I love the Rock and Roll Express, and they were the originators, but these guys kind of just came along and ripped off all their shit and did it better.
So I got to put them on here, and I know it's a tag team.
Synchronized
and I know we're
moves,
do tag
man.
Teams later. And
Rock and Roll Express had that double drop kick.
And
these guys had double everything.
Yeah,
they did
this
double
is,
goddamn everything the whole
is,
match.
This is just my excuse to get the beginning of Shawn Michaels on there, because as a very young child, like, this is where it, you know, this is why it devastated me when the man lost his smile, because we had been friends
got
for so long. You
pictures
know,
pictures of you dressed up as Shawn Michaels.
Well, hell yeah.
Kid. You got
all those
Shawn Michaels.
Those chaps.
Doing
God.
That little lunge pose.
Yeah, all
of side
it.
Lunge.
Yeah. I still run down ramps awkwardly like Definitely. He does, you know, with my butt out and like Bow-legged. My arms up at my sides, you know. Yeah.
Do you have perfect vision and you made that one eye of yours lazy just as an homage.
Just you got to drive it home.
Never seen anybody love Shawn Michaels so much.
Yeah. It's fair though. But number two, where are you at?
Okay. Number two. Oh, Jesus Christ. There's just nothing cooler than this guy. Back when I was 8 years old, I saw him.
Jim Duggan.
And saw boogers hanging out of his nose and that big weird dork in his tights because he never wore a jockstrap. No, I'm not talking about Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
I was going to say, because that's him.
No, yeah. I'm talking about the great Muta.
Ooh.
The coolest goddamn shit I'd ever seen. And this guy comes out in that robe, that whole hood that covered his whole head. And he pulls off that thing. He's got a full face full of face paint. Spitting mist is the coolest thing I've ever heard of. This guy spits poison mist that blinds his opponents.
Not just one kind of mist.
He's different. Three different kinds. He's
There's
got the,
three different kinds
the
of mist.
Burning red mist. He's got that deadly yellow mist.
Yep.
He got a black mist, I think, that was never really described. The probably couldn't even put to words how dangerous that was.
A green one, too, ain't there?
If you're going to be a great 80s wrestler, you got to have face paint on. And this guy does. But then he took it to the next level and spit fucking mist. So the first wrestling show I ever went to, you better believe I was sporting a poster board with a shitty drawing of the great Muta spitting mist on.
No, I bet it looked pretty good.
And he's the first guy I ever saw do a moonsault. So, you know, moonsault's fucking cool. Backflip, belly flop onto a dude. Like, come on. Nobody else is doing moonsaults as far as I was concerned.
See, I didn't have cable, so I wasn't getting the WCW product, you know.
Oh, man. TBS's Superstation came over the airwaves. You should have been able to get that.
No.
No, that was... No. Had to have a subscription for
you
that stuff?
To, yeah.
Oh, maybe it's not as much of a superstation as I've been thinking that it was.
No, you're thinking of WGN.
I really think I bought into Ted Turner's hype.
He good dude. He wouldn't lie to you.
He's a good dude. Yeah. Great Mood is my number two.
That's a good pick.
I loved him.
That's a good pick. Well, number one.
We're going to have
should
the same number one.
Should we
introduce it? Yeah.
Or should we just toss
we
it?
We already know.
To the man himself.
Let's let him introduce himself.
Ultimate Warrior, you've heard from Andre the Giant and Bobby the Brain Heenan. They believe, Warrior, that they have the advantage in this Intercontinental title bout. They believe that you fear the Giant.
Fear is an aberration. Fear is the air that cowards breathe. Fear is the first taste of defeat. The warrior only breathes the air of the brave, and the warrior only feasts on the fruit of victory.
Okay, yeah. There you have it. That's
the guy.
Both of our number ones. I knew it was going to happen this way. There was no question.
There's no.
We both love the Ultimate Warrior.
Ultimate answer aside from this one.
Back then, Hulk Hogan ruled the day. He was on top of the world, the biggest guy, but...
There's a guy I know called the Iron Sheik.
Yeah.
And to quote him, fuck the Hulk Hogan.
Fuck the Hulk Hogan. We were Ultimate Warrior kids.
Hell yeah.
For one of the most iconic moments in my
Hell
childhood.
Yeah.
That big buildup. WrestleMania 6, good guy versus good guy.
WrestleMania
I blew 6. My mind. Didn't even know you could do that. Two good guys fighting each other, and man...
Are you talking about... The Ultimate Challenge.
The Ultimate Challenge. IC Champion versus World Champion. Champion versus Champion, title for title. Who was your pick? Everybody was talking. Who's going to win? Like, there was lots of debate. Lots of fevered debate going on in
so
the playgrounds.
Important. It's huge. It's the biggest thing ever. It's Ultimate Warrior versus the Golden Boy, the Pukester.
Boo.
The Pukester, Hulk Hogan.
I hated that guy, man. His bald head and his mustache looked so weird
to me
when
like
I was
an idiot.
A kid.
Yeah.
He did look like an idiot.
Nobody realized he was bald. He should have had to have been a bad guy, a heel,
to be fair,
he was bald.
Really good at hiding the fact that he was bald.
Oh, yeah, I guess
you
so.
Wear a bandana 24/7. Like,
but he didn't.
Was like, oh, he's just in a bandana.
But he was wrestling around bald back then. He wasn't wrestling in a bandana like
no.
he did in WCW.
I mean, he would these days, I'm sure, if he had to wrestle.
Oh, absolutely. But Ultimate Warrior was the best. I can remember watching, we were talking about WrestleMania 6, the Ultimate Challenge. And this is, that was 1990. April of 90, I think.
Sounds about thereabouts.
And I know we watched it way after the fact, and at the time I was keeping up on Superstars, so I know who had what belt. I know what was going on out of the pay-per-views.
You're just a proto, and like, I'm watching internet shit. You're listening to ham radio stuff, like people talking about wrestling results.
Oh, I got that ham ham wrestling.
R-A-S-S-L-I-N, that's wrestling.
Ham wrestling you're listening to.
So I'm Inside coming out of Scoop. This, and I'm watching this on, what was the big VHS, their distributor?
Coliseum Video.
Coliseum Home Video.
Our man Tony Schiavone did a lot of producing for that, I understand it.
Well, you know, you got to make that money.
Yeah, he's a man of many talents.
But I'm watching it way after the fact. I know who wins, but it's still exciting to see, and I got my dork little brother with me.
Oh, That
real Michael,
preppy, rich
that,
guy
that
right
Michael
now?
Wall Street, that Erwin R. Scheister.
He's just such like a snobby, yuppie white guy right now that I can't even really imagine
he's
him
like,
as a young kid.
He's like the horseman without the fun.
Was he ever just like a wide-eyed young kid, or was he still just like
he
paying
was wearing
people
a suit.
Off
we're watching. We're watching this.
Looking like he's always smelling a fart.
Yeah, we're watching this Coliseum Home Video as kids, and he's got this Bears helmet on. And he's
what an idiot.
Yeah, I don't know why he's wearing a helmet. What an idiot. What were you thinking? We're watching this match, and I'm pro Warrior, and he's all pro Hulk, and he's getting real into it. And finally, I hit him with
probably because Hulk got bigger paydays.
Either way,
he was a fan.
That's probably it. Yeah. I hit him with the Equalizer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Hulk doesn't win this match, right?
Were there spoiler alerts back then?
I just gave him one.
Wow.
Yeah.
So what'd he do?
What's a young Hulkster fan to do?
Well, I don't know. He'd get real salty.
Starts crying.
Oh, no.
He starts crying.
I was picturing him.
So then he's wearing that dumb football
fighting back
helmet.
Or something. He's crying in a football helmet.
So I start shooting darts at it, right? You know, with a dart gun. And they're
like
just
a
sticking.
Suction dart.
And this is just making him more upset about life.
Oh, we should get a nice like little watercolor commission to him crying with a Bears helmet with a couple of suction darts stuck to it.
Watching Hulk Hogan lose.
I kind of had a similar conversation with my dad. I remember going into this match where I was real pumped up about the Warrior. I was like, he's going to do it. He's going to take down Hogan. And my dad was kind of just like, well, you know Hulk Hogan's not going to lose, right? And I was like, no, Dad. Like, no, the Warriors, though, he's like got the power of all the Warriors. Like, it's
floating through the veins.
Not just equal to, but greater than Hulkamania. So he's going to really do it. Like, my dad was trying to, like, lay it out for me. Like, no, kid, like, Hulk Hogan's going to win. Like, this is how it goes. Hulk Hogan wins. Like, don't get your hopes up, dum-dum. And I was like, look, man, you're the dum-dum because the Ultimate Warrior did win, and it was great. He's got the face paint. He's got the tassels, and there's probably no other wrestler who more just iconically just, like, personifies that thing we love where cocaine and steroids mix and create a beautiful disaster.
They make the Ultimate Warrior.
This man's a steroid freak. He's a speed freak. He's screams gibberish like no one else has screamed gibberish before.
Nothing but yelling promos.
He's the greatest of all time when it comes to yelling unintelligible 1980s promos.
Do you want to we're on the subject of Ultimate Warrior. Do you want to talk about WrestleMania 7 right now? Or is that for a later date and time?
Are we talking about? I think we're talking about WrestleMania 8.
Oh, 8. I'm sorry. Indy. In Indianapolis.
Yeah, that's a sad memory for me. Yeah. My big Christmas present that year was tickets to WrestleMania 8. Just a couple hours down the road in Indianapolis. Why not make the trip?
Oh, see another one.
He had that big Ric Flair versus Randy Savage thing going. That was the two greatest of all time. And it was big. I was excited about it. But, you know, I just woke up that morning just shitting, fucking just pissing out of my ass.
Green mist or yellow mist?
Just that devious, smelly brown mist. Oh. Just vomiting, projectile rainbow mist vomit. Oof. I kept trying to tell my mom, like, no, Mom, it's cool. I'm cool. We can still make it to WrestleMania. Oh, no. So, yeah, I didn't get to go to WrestleMania, and I had to watch it on the goddamn dumb TV.
That's not the same thing.
While I was just shitting myself and that's puking myself. Thing. I was. Wow. But then, yeah, Ultimate Warrior makes his big comeback after being fired or whatever for being an asshole. Like, I was wondering where he was
for months.
For being
a realist?
Just like, where is this guy? He's my favorite guy. Where's he been? What's going on? And then he makes his big return at the end of the Hulk Hogan Sid Justice match. I was going to be there, and I missed it, and I'm still fucking upset about it.
Did your mom throw the tickets away?
She's a son of a bitch. I think she, like,
burn the tickets in front of you.
Flush them down the toilet in front of me.
Burn them in front of you.
Your dreams are shattered, you idiot kid. You're not going to WrestleMania. I was just like, hook me up with a colostomy bag. Like, it's WrestleMania, man. Like, you think I'm going to be the only one shitting myself in Indianapolis? That's a town full of scumbags.
Oh, and back then?
Oh, yeah.
Before it was nice?
Probably even worse.
Everybody was shitting themselves. Nice. Ish.
Nice-ish. Yeah, that makes sense.
But yeah, I texted the complete directions to Parts Unknown promo to my girlfriend.
Okay, why?
Because she needed to know how to get to Parts Unknown. She didn't really understand about Parts Unknown. Uh-huh. And like, I'm not going to explain it to you. That's beyond me.
Oh, yeah,
so I'm going to let the expert himself do it. So
the
only
man who can put it into sort of words, pseudo words.
They counted as words, yeah. So I text the entire promo to her. Her phone died, never to work again.
She literally
had to buy a new phone because the power of the warrior.
The power of distrustity.
Destroyed. The power of distrustity.
Destroyed that.
Ruined that outdated, antiquated, bullshit phone she had.
What are you going to do about that genius bar?
Nothing you can do.
Nothing you can do against the power of the warrior. Yeah, we're holding hands on this one. Number one 80s pro wrestler, as long as you're a dumb kid.
Number one wrestler of all time.
Number one guy who used the most hairspray, too. Like, number one consumer of hairspray back in the 80s, I think, on that roster.
Oh, his shit was teased to the moon.
Teased up, man, and rock hard. Rock hard.
Like the rest of them.
I mean, like that hole in the ozone layer thing that was happening back there for a few years. You notice once Ultimate Warrior's wrestling career stopped, like they
stopped talking about that shit. Yeah, because it was bullshit. They were all Hogan fans trying to chase him out the game.
Once he shaved his head, it didn't matter anymore.
Guys are just running to the
climate
ring.
Climate change is a hoax.
As fast as he can, he's gassed before he gets in the ring. And he's having squash
matches.
Because
he's got all that steroid muscle on his frame. You know how hard it is to carry that shit around?
How's a young kid not supposed to like this guy? Just destroying people?
I would pity the young, crybaby, idiot kid who liked Hulk Hogan more than he liked the Ultimate Warrior and ultimately had to watch that guy be like a racist who fucks his friends' wives.
Yeah, so yeah. Dave, thanks for listening. We appreciate that.
That's gonna wrap it up for this week.
Get us on the social medias. We got a big announcement. We're kind of a big deal.
Kind of a big deal on
the Instagrams.
We got Instagram going. Uh-huh. Baby Oil and Blow.
Who's following our Instagram?
Certified followed by Just Incredible, so you know we're legit.
That kind of makes us honorary members
of
the clique, don't it?
Yep. Hit up our Twitter. I'm posting great matches every day. Match of the day,
great
like
matches.
1980s matches.
You need that fix.
Next week, we're going to come back. We're going to start talking about some WWF again. We got a big show coming up chronologically.
Ooh.
Saturday night's main event from May 3rd,
Saturday
1986.
Night.
So if you're following along, watch that show, May 3rd, 1986, Saturday night main event, and we'll come back and we'll talk about it.
On Baby Oil and Blow.